Now we get to an important part of the program. We have for years and years in our conference done what we refer to as the nuts and bolts. And consistently, when we receive evaluations, we get quite a bit of commentary about nuts and bolts. And it's important because many of you in the field don't always have access to people in policymaking positions, people who can answer your questions, people that you can direct a whole number of things that you have to face in your work every day. And this is an opportunity to do that. Now, our time is limited, obviously. I don't know that we can get all our questions answered, but you don't get a chance often to go to an administrator, an undersecretary, people in high-level positions to say, I've got this issue and I need some help. So the nuts and bolts gives you that opportunity. And we want you to take full advantage of that opportunity. What we will do this morning is we will ask representatives from the Department of Agriculture, a representative from the Department of Housing and Urban Development, and a representative from the Veterans Administration to come up, make brief policy overview statements. After that, we will take a maybe 15-minute break, and we will divide into groups. We will have one group go with the Department of Agriculture and Rural Development. So if you have questions, if you want to raise issues with people from rural development, they will be on this side? On this side. We will also break out the Department of Housing and Urban Development staff, and they will be on this side. See that? You see why I need the staff? I don't know what I'm doing. And the Veterans Administration, people who have questions of the Veterans Administration will go across the hall. Okay, so we'll have staff to guide you. We got word that Undersecretary Mensa is on the way, but not quite here. So I don't know, Tony, if that falls on you. If it does, you know, when the boss is in Iran, you got to pick it up. That's the way it goes. You met the Undersecretary last night. I will not introduce her, but I will ask Tony to come up and represent her. From the Department of Housing and Urban Development, we have Dr. Jackie Williams. Let me just tell you a few things about Dr. Williams. She has 30 years of experience in economic development in the public and nonprofit sectors at the local, state, federal, and university sectors. A public administrator and adjunct professor, she is a national speaker, moderator, and facilitator. Dr. Williams serves as the founding director of the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development's Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development in Washington, D.C. She oversees the management and oversight of the Self-Help Homeownership Opportunity Program, Veterans Home Rehabilitation Program, Rural Housing and Economic Development Program, Rural Gateway Clearinghouse, Border Community Capital Initiative, Delta Community Capital Initiative, Appalachia Economic Development Initiative, and the Church Arson Program. As a senior advisor, Dr. Williams served as HUD's representative for the White House Council on Environmental Qualities Appalachian Regional Development Initiative. She earned a PhD in public policy and administration from Jackson State University, Jackson, Mississippi. She holds a master's NMS in educational administration, supervision, and ABS in computer science. From the Veterans Affairs Administration, we have Mr. Michael Frew. Mr. Frew is the director of the Loan Guarantee Service in the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs. He directs the national loan program responsible for helping veterans obtain mortgages to purchase homes, adapt homes to accommodate certain service-connected disabilities, retain their homes if they experience financial difficulties, as well as the program that sells REO properties acquired through this process. He previously worked at the Structured Finance Group at PricewaterhouseCoopers, as well as Bankers Trust's Asset Securitization Program. He owned a mortgage bank based in North Carolina. He has a BS in mathematics from Pepperdine University and an MBA in business administration from George Washington University. So if the three of you would come up, please. I'm sorry. Whatever you want.
Oh. all yours.
Good morning, everyone, and it's good to see you again. It's always good to engage with you during this time of the year to hear what you have to say about the work that we do at HUD when it comes to rural housing and economic development. But I want to yield and introduce Valerie Piper. Valerie serves as the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Economic Development and has served as HUD's representative for the White House Rural Council. So I'm going to yield for her to make some points, and then I'll wrap up with programs and initiatives under the Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development that we want to engage with throughout the process. Valerie.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Jackie. I'd ask to actually come say just a few words of thanks to all of you and to Jackie. I'm really here to support the terrific staff of the Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development who have for 16 years now and counting served rural America nationwide, and I think are with some terrific new staff additions. Everybody's here over at this table right now, we'll be with you all day. That staff is here to support you going forward through this next transition and you know, your work in the future. So you know, it's been my privilege to serve in the administration for the last 6 years, and that has been a period of declining resources, which makes work at the federal level feel a lot more like working with a scrappy rural nonprofit. Okay. Jackie and I used to joke about zero-based budgeting every year. And it forces you to figure out how to work together with your colleagues to get more impact out of the resources you have. I was very struck by a number of the report outs speaking to that same set of issues. You know, how you have to you know, really innovate by communicating and figuring out where you can contribute different types of resources and capacities to share goals. And I think this group of agencies has been very, very focused on that work and trying to be of better use to those of you doing that work in the field during my time in federal service. I have to say, you know, like coming to the White House Rural Council meetings early in my tenure was an incredibly inspiring process, because the level of excitement and creativity among the staff in the room, both appointees and career, was so high for really looking hard at the unique issues of working in rural and tribal communities. And that excitement yielded a lot of interagency initiatives, rural jobs accelerators, the power initiative to help coal communities diversify the economy, retrain workers. A lot of work, as all of you know, around food systems as an economic development driver, rural health investments and telemedicine, broadband, the community capital initiatives, which Jackie will speak a little bit about later on, where we were working with USDA and the Department of Treasury. There's also been a fair amount of work done across agencies around technical assistance and capacity building, which also came out of a lot of the report outs as the kinds of things that can help to add value as you all work across sectors and across functions locally to figure out how to solve problems in your communities. And you know, we're really thinking hard about how to keep that going. We've been meeting with our colleagues that focus on rural and tribal areas in the federal system. We've done an environmental scan of all the technical assistance and capacity building programs that are available from federal agencies and other sources. There are over 700, right? So what would it be like if we, you know, all talked together on a consistent basis to figure out how to, you know, figure out what the best niche is for all of our work and how to make it add up to more? You know, that's really sort of where we've been focusing our efforts in the past several months. And we're looking forward to building on the Rural Gateway activities that the Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development oversees, and work with our agency partners to figure out how better to get information out about programs that are forthcoming from all the federal agencies through the peer-to-peer conference calls, through the website and other activities of HUD, and you know, working with USDA, which has so many staff on the ground, you know, who can be, you know, closer to rural areas. We're also looking forward to hearing more from you all in a more consistent manner, and really trying to set up opportunities to talk with HAC on a more regular basis, just to kind of compare notes about what's going on and where we might focus our next set of efforts. And we also have a survey out for 30 days of public comment right now called the Community Development Marketplace, which basically will enable community leaders to tell us about projects that they're currently working on, so that in a more consistent way we can kind of, you know, and targeted way we can provide information to folks that are trying to develop different types of projects, whether they're real estate or services. And just kind of connect you with information real time in a little bit more nimble way. So we're trying to just improve on all those practices, and that will be in the able hands at HUD of Jackie Williams and her staff, but with the deep partnership and just incredible enthusiasm that I've seen among the career public servants at the other agencies that we're working with. So once again, it's been my privilege to be here today and to work with some of you over the last 6 years, and I'm going to be your biggest fan once I leave federal service. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Valerie. Just to kind of wrap up on some final points in terms of the programs and initiatives under the Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development, we assumed the SHOP program about a year ago and have been working with our grantees. We conducted listening sessions early this year to get an idea of how to strengthen the program, understand some of their accomplishments, and understand the impact on our local communities in terms of providing affordable houses to families. One of the major tasks that we've been looking at is streamlining the program to make it easier for our grantees to provide a service to our local communities. So we look to hear from you during the nuts and bolts in terms of any comments, any inputs in terms of continuing to shape in that program. Another program that's new, and it was a part of the FY16 appropriation under the SHOP line item, is the Veterans Home Rehabilitation Program. And that program was established by Congress to help support disabled veterans, where we are going to provide funding to national and regional nonprofit organizations to help modify and rehab the homes of disabled veterans, low-income disabled veterans. And so that's something that you would look forward to in the next fiscal year. So that's new to HUD and comes under the SHOP appropriation. And then finally, we have been working with USDA, EPA at this point in terms of developing a rural and tribal technical assistance strategy. We have a working group that we convened November last year, and we have been working with the support of Econometrica, one of our contractors, and Dore Sitko is here today. So we could, as a part of the process, kind of hear from you in terms of what you think a rural and tribal TA strategy would look like in terms of your local communities. So that's something else that we look forward to hearing from you in terms of the nuts and bolts session. In closing, I want to introduce the Office of Rural Housing and Economic Development team, and they're the face of the office. When you call that 1-877 Rural Gateway number, these are the individuals who help to research any questions or make sure that you know that we hear you and we're shaping policy to support your needs. Dan Young, if you would stand, Steve Cherney, Sylvia Purvis, as well as Richard Bernard, and you would be able to engage and ask questions and meet with them during nuts and bolts. Thanks again, Moises, for inviting us to come and always get to spend time with those of you who are on the front line and you're committed to serving rural communities and rural America. We thank you. Thanks, Moises.
Good morning.
Morning.
Now, thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to come and speak to you today. And I absolutely, truly mean that, because for the last couple months, I've not done what I've done for the first 25 years of my career. I've been asked to be chief of staff of VBA, and very different role than what I've done before. But before that, I joined VA 14 years ago after about 20 years in housing and mortgage finance. And you know, I grew to run the loan guarantee program, or the VA home loan program, and it's an absolute passion of mine. So when I got a chance to come here, and thank you, Moises, for the invitation, I jumped at it because I actually miss it, and I'm happy to get back and talk about it again. But for those of you that don't know, the Department of Veteran Affairs has a very simple home loan mission. You know, we exist to help veterans get a house, keep a house, and adapt a house if they need it. Now, however, we don't build houses, we don't sell houses, we don't make loans, we don't do any of the things that enable our mission. We actually rely on people like you and organizations like HAC to help us deliver our mission to veterans. Since 1944, I guess 72 years ago when the program started, we've made almost 23 million loans to veterans. You know, 23 million to loans, about $2 trillion worth of housing loans that we've guaranteed around the country. And honestly, most of our loans are in urban and suburban areas, but about 15 to 20% are in rural areas. That's about 2.5 to 3 million of veterans with our loan product that live in rural areas. And there are many, many more veterans who did not get a VA loan that live in rural America. I think it's about 30-35% of veteran population lives in rural America. So thank you for your help in helping them get housing. So part of our goal, as I said, is to try to help veterans get a house, but since we don't deliver the benefit, it really forces us to rely on the private industry. So no conversation from me to the industry would be complete without me saying thank you, thank you, thank you for the work you do every day in rural communities to help veterans get housing. The loan program started, as I said, 72 years ago at VA with the GI Bill. In 1944, it looked very different than it did today. You know, we've changed a lot over the years, but there's a couple of things that have not changed. And I want to hit a couple of them because they're very important for veterans no matter where they live. The first is we're one of the few no down payment national mortgage programs. So anywhere in the country that a veteran goes to get a house, they don't need to come up with a down payment. Our average mortgage the last couple of years is about $240,000. So for those veterans, they're saving $24,000 to $48,000 on a down payment, which is a tremendous asset for them. And I think one of the reasons that our loans are so successful in avoiding foreclosure, because that's money that the veterans get to keep in their pocket and use if they have any financial hardship going forward. Now, there's no prepayment penalty. We put strict limits on closing costs, so we try to keep the cost down for the veteran. It's a reusable benefit. They can go again and again throughout their life to use it. And probably one of the biggest benefits, aside from no down payment, is that there's no PMI. The mortgage insurance cost alone for veterans that got loans just last year, for the life of their loan, they'll save over $50 billion on their mortgage throughout the life. That's a tremendous amount of money. And I said they're saving $24,000 is a good thing for the veteran that's not paying a down payment. Not paying MI gives them even more cushion to avoid default or avoid foreclosure if they do have default, because that money's not being tied up in their mortgage. Now, our program's changed. We've grown a lot in the last several years. Historically, we've been about 2% of the mortgage market, but for the last 3 or 4 years, we've topped out at 16%, and we've settled in around 9 or 10%. So 9 or 10% of a $10 trillion market is a massive market. And I said we've already had $2 trillion worth of loans outstanding since our program started. I feel like VA is definitely a significant part of the mortgage fabric across the United States. You know, but we've done a lot of things over the years to get better, because if I can't encourage lenders to make a VA loan, then it won't matter what veterans want. You know, we want them to use this benefit because we think it's a great benefit. We've taken a lot of strides in the last several years, certainly since I've been director of the VA Home Loan Program, to make our product better for lenders and for servicers and for anyone else that touches it, because we want to help you. Like Jerry Maguire, let me help you. We want you to want to use our product for veteran clients around the world. Last year, we processed over 500,000 appraisals, and we did it electronically. Every appraisal comes in electronically. We have a new tool that lets us evaluate the appraisal immediately, and we know our turn time on appraisals is about 7.5 days. Now, I look continually, or I did look when I was running the program, on how long does it take a loan to originate. Because again, if it's a barrier for a lender, they're not going to want to choose it. And we did in the last couple years through changing the way we handle appraisals, changing the way we handle certificates of eligibility. That process is the entryway for veterans to get in the program. We had over 1 million requests for a certificate of eligibility last year, and we handled 700 to 1,000 of them instantly, electronically, without anyone at VA having to pick up a phone or check an email or do anything. It just systematically, we know a lot about veterans now. 70% of those requests were handled instantly. The other 300,000 required some work, and we've made a lot of changes, and John Bellin back drove this over the last 2 years. The time it takes to get a COE dropped from 26 days to 2 days. And if you think, if someone's making an offer on a house, the lender or the seller doesn't want to wait 26 days plus a month to get financing. They want to sell it in about a month to 45 days. So by cutting out 24 days in the process, we made a big driver to getting to a closing on time. I look at closing times constantly. We got to on par with conventional financing over the years, but the last couple months it's gone up again. We're 4 or 5 days slower than conventional financing, and that's not acceptable. So we're continually looking for more ways to get faster. And I think one of the biggest signs to me that the VA loan is making progress is that the interest rate on a VA loan is lower and has been lower than conventional loans, lower than FHA loans, lower than USDA for the last several years. To me, that's a sign that lenders believe that we're not an onerous product. Servicers believe it's not too expensive to service our product anymore. And those are drivers that we continually focus on so that we can take the pain out of it. Given your work with veterans in rural areas, I did want to talk about one program that one of my former employees, Richard Javot, was here earlier to talk about, and that's our Native American Direct Loan Program, or NADL. NADL is one of my favorite benefits that VA has because I think it provides an incredible resource to a community that, when I go out to visit over the last several years, is in desperate need of adequate and stable housing. I used to work with Gina Capra, the head of our rural health, and she'd continually tell me how stable and safe housing is one of the primary indicators of health for people anywhere in the country, veterans, no different than anyone else. And in Indian country and on tribal lands, housing is definitely a desperate need. So the NADL program is something that started several years ago when we were having trouble getting lenders to make loans to veterans on tribal land. It works almost the same as our regular program. We have a no down payment, there's no mortgage insurance. The only difference is VA is the lender. We set the interest rate, we do the underwriting. We're dealing with people that we feel it's our sacred duty to serve, so we're doing everything we can to get to a yes. No credit's not a problem. We're willing to work with the borrower to find a way to get them into a home. And I said it's one of my favorite programs because it was such an underutilized benefit, and about 3 years ago I made a commitment to get out to every single federally recognized tribe in the country to talk about this and try to offer it to their tribal members. We can't make a loan to a veteran in a tribe unless we have an MOU. And we've been working with FHA and USDA on what we have a joint MOU, but we also have a lot of tribes where we have an individual VA MOU with the tribal leaders. And I'm really happy to say that as of this year, we've gotten out to every single tribe in the country, and we repeatedly get out to them. Yep, get out. Thank you. It's a commitment I made, but it's not one that's easy to do because they're not located next to airports. So we're relying a lot on, not big airports anyway. So we rely on a lot of community help. The Federal Reserve has been a big help in outreach with us. We have Office of Tribal Government Relations to help us, but we do a lot of phone calls. We do a lot of email. We try to develop relationships at conferences that continue in between times that we actually get to meet. And it's been very successful. Since we started, we've had about 25 new MOUs with tribes. We're up to just under 100 MOUs, which is about 20% of the federally recognized tribes. We want to get to 100%. I want to have an MOU with every single tribe. We've actually made a lot more loans the last couple years. It's a small program, but we've done 133 loans in the last 2 years, which is about $35 million worth of loans. It's not a huge number, but it's significant to those 133 families. And those tribes that, quite honestly, can use their money for housing on non-veterans. So it helps across the board. So we've done a lot to change over the last couple years. John Bell's here. I'm going to be with him as we stay after this to talk about, I think we call it the nuts and bolts of VA and FHA. And we are here to help you. I'm not kidding when I say that we 100% depend on you and others like you around the country to help us deliver our benefits. So Thank you again for all you do to help us deliver that benefit. And if you have any questions, please feel free to stop by afterwards.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you. Apparently, this is what I'm going to say.
They're trying to keep his remarks limited.
Would you all please stand up, though? Please stand up. We have to do your morning exercise. You've been eating, you've been talking, been thinking. So please, reach for the sky. Reach for that sky. Reach for your waist. Reach for your waist. Try your knees just a little bit. Try your knees. Back to the sky. Okay, sit down. Here we go. Okay. Good morning, folks. Good morning.
Is that on your script?
That was on the script. It says number one.
Calisthenics.
Hey guys, I'm going to go out, try to go real quick. Lisa may be in, but I'm going to go through as many of these things real quickly. I want to really cover just. Is she here? Lisa, you want to come up?
So many tribes.
Okay. I am done. Thank you very much. That was. Am I done? Okay. Let me tell you three things that I think she'll go into more detail. Really want to talk about program performance, process improvement within that. We need your help on that. We've been real good. We have some opportunities that we think you need to capitalize on very quickly. And one of them happens to be what we're trying to encourage you to help us federal agencies focus on the five aspirations of customer service. You need to help us do this. They are the following. You have to hold us accountable for these five things. First thing is predictability. Is our program and funding and process predictable? If we say we're going to do it in 60 days, do we do it in 60 days? If no, work with us. Second one is it consistent? Is it done the same way in every state so you don't have different judgments, interpretations of programs? We need to work on that with you. Next one is what we call quality accuracy of data. We need your help. We have some tools right now that you can find out all this information you wanted on every investment from rural housing services in your state. Every investment, housing, multifamily, community facilities, home repair, all that's on for free on our website. Go there. Go get it. So predictability, consistency, quality, and accuracy. And the next one's called enhanced communication. The reason we're getting better is because we talk with you more and you give us input and feedback. We need you to help us. If we do those four things, predictability, consistency, quality, and accuracy, and enhanced communication, we become easier to work with. Okay, that is our goal. That's all of our goal. Mm-hmm. That's what we're trying to do. But to do that, you have to come with us. I'm stalling. Are we almost there? Hey, guys, we had a wonderful year. Lisa's going to go through this. But here's an opportunity because she's going to talk about some program performance. This is the time for you to find out who you want to be your state directors for USDA, who you want to be the undersecretary for USDA or for HUD, all these programs. Who should it be? It should be you guys. You should appoint folks from HAC to every one of these positions. I'm serious. Moises, the undersecretary, I take it back. Yeah, the undersecretary for rural development. Here it is. Germany, cricket. Wouldn't that be nice? We have somebody who understands the programs, understands our partners, but more importantly, understands our customers. Each state will have a state director. Those are all political positions. You should find a way to make sure somebody from our program areas are appointed. If you do not do that, you are not just missing an opportunity, you're passing it on to somebody else, and you may get somebody who doesn't want to do those five aspirations of customer service. Oh, great opportunities, guys. I'm still stalling. I don't want to do the talking points because they're very good. These are very, very good. So here's one more opportunity you have. If you use our tools, we have this other website called Preserving Multifamily Property. It'll tell you every property when it's maturing by date, the information about that property. Go to the website. We need your help to improve the website because when you have a great undersecretary like Lisa Mensa, who can talk about the great things we're doing, the process improvements, and the great performance we have. Please help me welcome Lisa Mensa, please. Okay.
Oh, brother. Not even water.
That's right. I got you water.
Oh.
Oh, boy. It's, I think the best training for undersecretary is being a mom, because you're always thrown into things like this. So I apologize for the delay. And may I just begin this morning with a huge thank you for last night. It was an absolute honor to be here and to receive the award, but more to receive what I've been feeling, and I snuck in here on Tuesday too, which is just so much support for not only me, but this team that stood up here last night with me at USDA and the Rural Housing Services. So truthfully, heartfelt, thank you. It is deeply, deeply, deeply meaningful. As some of you will remember, Hack and I have a special relationship as I took this position. Your conference 2 years ago happened after I had been confirmed by the Senate, but not yet sworn in. So Moises, I remember you introduced me in it with my title at the time, which was Citizen Mensa. I'm going to have that title again in 4 weeks. So I, really, that was such an important moment for me. And I remember joining you 2 years ago in the conversation around persistent poverty, and really a conversation about where had we been. Where had this 30-year journey or 40-year journey really taken us in rural America? And I color my gray, but I'm very old, and I have I've been on this journey with you really since the 80s. I'm thinking about how money reaches low-income places, how money develops America. And I know Hack has been on that journey. And I've been using the phrase, the unfinished work of building America. And for me, leading rural development has been a chance to say, in the name of this president, and I know it will be in future presidents, we are not done yet. This country isn't done yet. We've left too many Americans behind. And if you have the D in your name, development, it means that there's more work ahead, that we have the resources. You've heard from my amazing rural housing secretary. Secretary, I'm promoting you.
I still have a job.
Administrator of Rural Housing Services. And I think one thing that we know very clearly now about rural development, and I will get to the prepared remarks about rural development in our year, but this is a management job. This is a serious management job. And you deserve serious attention. Rural Development manages $30 billion of program authority each year. That's a serious job. It's almost unknown. And these housing resources, they're half of it. They're half of a $215 billion portfolio, much of it in the guaranteed portfolio. And why is it so big right now? Because we just went through another crisis. And our ability as a country to have facilities that were already in place, like the 502 guaranteed, helped heal a horrible rupture in our markets. And so, my goodness, I will talk more, I'll end on the future, but we must stay serious about the management challenge in the Department of Agriculture to run these resources and run them well. And you must continue to hold us accountable, hold anybody who holds these seats, because you deserve it. The management of these resources, and it's hard to talk about the public sector as deserving of serious managers. There's so much vilification of federal workers, but my goodness, how else? I mean, think about the lift in the private sector of managing this levels of billions of dollars of exposure. It's a huge job, and we do it with outdated computer systems, sure, but that's because, you know, you have to fight 10 times as hard to modernize inside the federal government. It's not a will question. It's that it's difficult. So I'll come back to that. But I want to thank you because in this room, I think you do understand the longevity of this challenge. I want to say a little bit about what's happened this year. And most of the time, this is a recitation of successes that people don't want to listen to. But I want you to listen to me because I think we're going to need your voices to trumpet some successes. And I've heard a little bit about this conference that the successes haven't always been what's been talked about by our members of Congress. So I want you to have the facts. This was a big and wonderful year for the Rural Housing Services. We haven't finished all the work, but this was a big work. My word, I had one word, core. Focus on our core and Tony and the team really did that. So we used every dollar this year, and you know it, in our major multifamily programs, our Section 515, our Section 538 multifamily housing loan guarantees, our preservation, our revitalization loans and grants, rental assistance and vouchers. This was such a huge year for us, and we are thankful. And in the single family housing, we not only used every dollar of the $900 million that Congress provided to us in the regular program level, but we were able to go back and get an additional $50 million. They said it couldn't be done, but we did it to help yet just 400 more families. And the reason I love telling this is because everybody in this room understands why 400 families matters in rural America, why we should fight, why we should say if we finish the money and there's a little bit of way to squirm at the end of the fiscal year, we should do it. We provided housing opportunities to over 116,000 families through our guaranteed loan program. It's just such a crucial piece. It means when we're doing a guarantee, we're not supplanting the market. We're making the market work. And I think that's the way these tools have been set up. We made over 3,100 single-family housing repair loans to very low-income homeowners, up from just under 2,000. So going from 2,000 to 3,100, that is management pushing. And over 5,000 home repair grants. Don't let anybody tell you this is a broken system that can't be fixed. It can, and we're going to help a lot of other people fix their lives and their homes when we do it. We also obligated all of the $5 million of our Section 524 rural housing site loans for the first time in recent memory. And then there's our community facilities program. And this I'm very, very proud of. People said to me it couldn't be done, that we'd just never reach it. Congress had expanded our authority to $2.2 billion. And we had guarantee funds on top of that. But we did it this year. We did it. $2.2 billion serving over 26 million rural Americans through our community facility community facilities program. We put in some strategies. One of them I'm so proud of, and that's our relending program, with the CF relending team. I'm just so thankful to everybody in this room that had a good word for us on that. But really, to be able finally to relend some funds, to bring in some partners who would have more time than we did. That's a $400 million redeployment of funds in the hands of community lenders. And I'm really proud of the team, Tony, for that. And I just want to give a shout out, because that really is a first time. Now, if you've heard from Tony Hernandez, you know about the theme of process improvement. And I know that makes people's eyes glaze over if you're a big picture person. But help us on this. Process improvement matters. In our multifamily programs, it includes streamlining the process to transfer properties to new owners. It's the thing that Senator Merkley spoke about last night when we talked about our new preliminary assessment tool and the introduction of a rental assistance obligation tool that helps us manage the vouchers. See, we want to leave this institution better than we found it, and that includes being able to be more transparent. In our single-family housing program, we've instituted a paperless loan documentation. We've streamlined the guaranteed loan process for approved third-party lenders, and we've reduced processing times for delinquencies and loss claims. Those are a lot of words, but really, we're really getting a more efficient shop inside, and we need to stay on this. So there have also been program innovations. We've been pushing hard to preserve properties. You know how serious this is. This is 50-year victories to create rural housing, and we are not going to let that go down. Our multifamily housing portfolio has to be able to last. Some of the properties, sure, are beyond renovation, but those who can be renovated or can be expanded into new ends, we wanted to improve that by using our full range of programmatic tool, releasing data and information to prospective buyers and conducting buyer and seller meetings and expanding our outreach. And people are noticing, like Senator Merkley. We expanded our single close construction loan program, which was previously just a pilot. And that we now have expanded nationwide. That allows lenders to receive loan guarantees immediately after closing, but before construction is complete, and letting them place their loans in Ginnie Mae pools more quickly. It's a win-win for lenders, for home builders, and for borrowers. I think that all of these process improvements have been possible because of our theme of partnership. And we want to continue to recognize the expertise and dedication of our partners. And this happened again in our Single Family Direct program, where we've finalized a new regulation on certified packagers. I see Joyce over there. I know we've been waiting for this for a long time. There was a lot of victories in this last 2 years. But this regulation allows us to build on a strong network of experienced agency-certified packagers to increase awareness of our housing programs. We understand that there are nonprofit partners who want to play a larger role in strengthening our multifamily program, and we developed a pilot program to incentivize the transfer of existing properties to nonprofits. And we know how critical nonprofits are to the important work of preserving our affordable housing. I think one thing that you may not know is that we've also been supporting research on pressing rural housing issues. And if you haven't met David Lifsitz and talked to him about research and the big thoughts, then you're missing a great conversation. Under David and Tony's leadership this past spring, we co-hosted a roundtable on access to mortgage credit in rural markets with the Center for American Progress and the White House Rural Council. Earlier, we partnered with the Federal Reserve Board to hold Rural Housing Forum. And we're working also with HAC and with the Urban Institute and with Smart Growth America. I really want to praise these efforts. I come most directly from a think tank. And when you can make rural housing sort of the hot ticket in Washington, that's a good sign. That's a sign that we take seriously this work and the researchers and the thinkers who know we must advance it. And that's where I want to end my remarks today, which is about advancing this work and what's in our future. And how can we keep moving forward? Because I actually believe we can keep moving forward. You've heard a lot of calls for what you must do, those of you who don't live in DC and you live in the parts of rural America that are now on the front lines because so much of rural America voted for the new president. And I think we go back to a phrase about, let's not waste this moment. If rural America is in the headlines, if flyover America refuses to be flown over anymore but wants to be listened to, then we must say that we have answers. And we must keep bringing the members of Congress and the president. My dream is that we'll see our new president-elect on a self-help building site sometime in the next 2 years. And when he does that, when he stands with the families whose sweat equity have built their own homes, I'm convinced he won't be able to deny the seriousness of this program and the seriousness of all the programs that relate to this. Where I think there's work to do at so many levels, but let me speak to you about what I still think is a federal role. I think our role is to continue to keep the pressure on resources that are not well understood. Secretary Vilsack said, maybe we've got the wrong name in the Farm Bill. I've got a new name. We should call it the Rural Development Bill. And the real case here is to put the people in the equation. Just talking about trade is not just a winner. Talking about the people of rural America is a winner. And the thing is, we have a department in rural development that works for those people. And it already works. Nobody has to think up new programs. We know how to streamline them. We know how to fix them. What it needs is more care and attention and more funding. And this is where I think we hold our I'm speaking as an Obama representative, the other side of the aisle, to account, because we need to grow. Let this president be the broadband president. You know, let the expansion come. You know, I say we think about growth in each of these line items, and even if it's modest growth, even if it's 10 to 15% growth a year, that's hundreds of families who will be in new homes, and it's frankly a rounding error in the big budget negotiations, but it's a rounding error that matters for rural America. So I hope the reward of this future is to continue to nurture this budget. And I say, if you're from any one of the states that's typically called red, keep making this case to your federal officials. Keep them on those self-help sites. Bring them to the places where the keys are handed off. You know, when Lyndon Johnson was able to say, you know, he was able to transform the housing challenge in rural America, Roosevelt turned the lights on. You know, what's this president going to be known for? I think if he expands this kind of budget, it will be a serious contribution. And it's not that hard. These are programs that work. They're already beloved by many members on both sides of the aisle. So I want to leave you with the sense that there's a strong foundation. We're housers, so we can talk about foundations. I think there's a strong foundation for the future. I think it's strong because of rooms like this, of people, as we heard in your awards last night, who work in the trenches, who celebrate every key, who celebrate every senior that gets a clean home, who celebrates families that come out of homelessness and come in, who celebrate the people of rural America. I think there are challenges throughout rural America, and if you were at the Department of Agriculture, you'd hear different speeches. You'd hear speeches about the challenges in trade, about the age of family farmers, the age of the average farmer who isn't a corporate farmer, you know, challenges all through our production agriculture system. But the challenge that links us to that big screen of what will move the rural economy is the challenge of the people. And that's the one you've got your hands around. And no more clear than when we're talking about where people live and how the workforce of rural America lives and how we keep the facilities of rural America alive. That's what you've been arguing for. And that is the work of the Rural Housing Services and of rural development. It's a precious part of this federal government. It's a part of government that deserves to flourish. And I think with your help, it will. So I want to thank you again for inviting me back and wish you many more good sessions as you conclude out this conference. Thank you.